Let's imagine that you work for a major streaming media provider, right? So you have, I don't know, some 100 million subscribers. So you've got, I don't know, 10,000 videos on your site or many more audio files, right? So for each user, you're going to have collected information on what they've watched, when they've watched it, how long they've watched it for, whether they went from this one to this one, did that work, was that good for them? And so maybe you've got 30,000 data points per user. We're now talking about trillions of data points, and your job is to try and predict what someone wants to watch or listen to next. Best of luck. So we've cleaned the data, we've transformed the data, everything's on the same scale, we've joined data sets together. The problem is, because we've joined data sets together, perhaps our data set has got quite large, right? Now, or maybe you just work for a company that has a lot of data. Certainly the general consensus these days is to collect as much data as you can, right? This isn't always a good idea. What we want, remember, is the smallest, most compact and useful data set we can. Otherwise, you're just going to be wasting CPU hours or GPU hours training on this, wasting time, right? We want to get to the knowledge as quickly as possible. And if you can do that with a small amount of data, that's going to be great. So we've got quite an interesting data set to look at today based on music. It's quite common these days when you're building something like a streaming service, for example, Spotify, you might want to have a recommender system. This is an idea where you've maybe clustered people who are similar in their tastes, you know what kind of music they're listening to, and you know the attributes of that music. And if you know that, you can say, well, this person likes high tempo music, so maybe he'd like this track as well. And this is how playlists are generated. One of the problems is that you're going to have to produce descriptions of the audio on things like tempo and how upbeat they are in order to machine learn on this kind of system, right? And that's what this data set's about. So we've collected a data set here today that is lots and lots of metadata on music tracks, right? Now these are freely available tracks and freely available data. We'll put a link in the description if you want to have a look at it yourself. I've cleaned it up a bit already because obviously I've been through the process of cleaning and transforming my data. Right, so we're going to load this. Now this takes quite a long time to do because there's quite a lot of attributes and quite a lot of instances. It's loaded, right? How much is this data? Well, we've got 13,500 observations, that's instances, and we've got 762 attributes, right? So that means another way of putting this in sort of machine learning parlance is we've got 13,000 instances and 760 features. Now, these features are a combination of things. So let's have a quick look at the columns we're looking at so we can see what this data set's about. So names of music all. Right, so we've got some 760 features or attributes, and you can see there's a lot of slightly meaningless text here. But if we look at the top, you'll see some actual things that may be familiar to us. So we've got the track ID, album ID, the genre. Right, so genre is an interesting one because maybe we can start to use some of these audio descriptions to predict what genre this music is or something like that. Things like the track number and the track duration, and then we get onto the actual audio description features. Now these have been generated by two different libraries. The first is called Librosa, which is a publicly available library for taking an MP3 and calculating musical sort of attributes of it. What we're trying to do here is represent our data in terms of attributes. An MP3 file is not an attribute, it's a lot of data. So can we summarize it in some way? Can we calculate by looking at the MP3? What the tempo is, what the amplitude is, how loud the track is, these kind of things. This is the kind of thing we're measuring, and a lot of these are going to go into a lot of detail down at kind of a waveform level. So we have the Librosa features first, and then if we scroll down, after a while we get to some Echoness features. Echoness is a company that produces very interesting features on music, and actually these are the features that power Spotify's recommender system and numerous others. We've got things like acousticness, how acoustic does it sound? We've got instrumentalness, I'm not convinced that's a word. Speechiness, to what extent is it speech or not speech? Right? And then things like tempo, how fast is it? And valence, how happy does it sound? Right? A track of zero would be quite sad, I guess. And a track of one will be really happy and upbeat. And then, of course, we've got a load of features that I've labeled temporal here, and these are going to be based on the actual music data themselves. Often when we talk about data reduction, what we're actually using is dimensionality reduction, right? One way of thinking about it, as we started, we've been looking at things like attributes, and we've been saying, what is the mean or the standard deviation of some attribute on our data, right? But actually, when we start to talk about clustering and machine learning, we're going to talk a little bit more about dimensions. Now, this is, in many ways, the number of attributes is the number of dimensions. It's just another term for the same thing. But certainly from a machine learning background, we refer to a lot of these things as dimensions. So you can imagine that if you've got some data here, so you've got your instances down here, and you've got your attributes across here. So in this case, our music data, we've got each song. So this is song one, this is song two, song three, and then all the attributes, so the temporal, echo nest attributes, its tempo and things like this. These are all dimensions in which this data can vary. So they can be different in the first dimension, which is the track ID, but they can also, down here, be different in this dimension, which is the tempo. When we say some data is 700 dimensional, what that actually means is it has 700 different ways or different attributes in which it can vary. And you can imagine that, first of all, this is going to get quite big quite quickly. Right? 700 attributes seems like a lot to me. Right? And depending on what the algorithm you're running is, it can get quite slow when you're running over this kind of size of data. And you can imagine this is a relatively small data set compared to what Spotify might deal with on a daily basis. But another way to think about this data is actually points in this space. So we have some 700 different attributes that you can vary, and when we take a specific track, it sits somewhere in this space. So if we were looking at it in just two dimensions, you know, track one might be over here, and track two over here, and track three over here. And in three dimensions, track four might be back at the back here. You can imagine the more dimensions we add, the further spread out these things are going to get. But we can still do all the same things we can in three dimensions in 700 dimensions. It just takes a little bit longer. So one of the problems is that some things like machine learning don't like to have too many dimensions. So things like linear regression can get quite slow if you have tens of thousands of attributes or dimensions. So remember that perhaps the default response to anyone collecting data is just to collect it all and worry about it later. Right? This is the time, unfortunately, when you have to worry about it. What we're trying to do is remove any redundant variables. If you've got two attributes of your music, like tempo and valence, that turn out to be exactly the same, why are we using both and making our problem that little bit harder? Right? Now, in actual fact, echo nest features are pretty good. They don't tend to correlate that strongly. But you might find where we've collected some data on a big scale, actually a lot of the variables are very, very similar all the time. And you can just remove some of them or combine some of them together and just make your problem that little bit easier. So let's look at this on the music data set and see what we can do. So the first thing we can do is we could remove duplicates. Right? This sounds like an obvious one, and perhaps one that we could also do during cleaning, but exactly when you do it doesn't really matter as long as you're paying attention. What we're gonna say is music all equals unique of music all. And what that's going to do is look through, find any duplicate rows, and remove them. The number of rows we've got will drop by some amount, let's see, thinking. This is where you need a timer. Actually, this is quite a slow process. You've got to consider that we're going to look through every single row and try and find any other rows that match. Okay, so this has removed about 40 rows. So this meant we had some duplicate tracks. You can imagine that things might get accidentally added to the database twice, or maybe two tracks are actually identical because they were released multiple times, or something like this. Now, what this is doing, the unique function actually finds rows that are exactly the same for every single attribute or every single dimension. Of course, in practice, you might find that you have two versions of the same track which differ by 1 second. They might have slightly different attributes. Hopefully, they will be very, very similar. So what we could also do is have a threshold where we said, these are too similar, they're the same thing, the name is the same, the artist is the same, and the audio descriptors are very, very similar. Maybe we should just remove one of them, right? This is the other thing you could do. Just for demonstration, what we're going to do is focus on just a few of the genres in this data set, right? Just to make things a little bit clearer for our visualizations. We're going to select just the classical, jazz, pop, and spoken word genres, right? Because these have a good distribution of different amounts in the data set. So we're going to run that. We're creating a list of genres. We're going to say music is musical, where any time where the genre is in that list of genres we just produced, right? And that's going to produce a much smaller data set of 1,600 observations of the same number of attributes or dimensions. Now, normally you would obviously keep most of your data in. This is just for a demonstration. But removing genres that aren't useful to you for your experiment is a perfectly reasonable way of reducing your data size if that's a problem.
Assuming they've been labelled right in the first place.
Right. That's on someone else. That's someone else's job. Let's imagine that 1600 is still too long. Now, actually, computers are getting pretty quick. Maybe 1600 observations is fine, but perhaps we want to remove some more. The first thing we could do is just chop off the data halfway and keep about half. Right, so let's try that first of all. So we're going to say the first music, that's the first few rows of our music, is rows 1 to 835 and all the columns. So we're going to run that. Right, and that's even smaller, right? So we can start to whittle down our data. This is not necessarily a good idea. We're assuming here that our genres are equally, you know, randomly sampled around our data set. That might not be true. You might have all the rock first and then all the pop or something like that. If you take the first few, you're just going to get all the rock, right? Depending on what you like, that might not be for you. So let's plot the genres in the normal data set. And you can see that we've got very little spoken word, but it is there. We have some classical, international, jazz and pop in sort of roughly the same amount. If we plot after we've selected the first 50, you can see we've lost two of the genres, right? We only have classical, international, and jazz, and there's hardly any jazz. That's not a good idea. So don't do that unless you know that your data is randomized, right? So this is not giving us a good representation of genres. If we wanted to predict genre, for example, based on the musical features, cutting out half the genres seems like an unwise decision. So a better thing to do would be to sample randomly from the data set. So what we're going to do is we're going to use the sample function to give us 835 random indices into this data, and then we're going to use that to index our music data frame instead. Right, that's this line here. And hopefully this will give us a better distribution. If we plot the original again, it looks like this, and you can see we've got a broad distribution. And then if we plot the randomized version, you can see we've still got some spoken, it's actually gone up slightly, but the distributions are broadly the same. So this has worked exactly how we want. Right? So how you select your data, if you're trying to make it a little bit smaller, is very, very important. And consider that obviously we only had 1600 here, and even this whole data set is only 1300 rows. You could imagine that you might have tens of millions of rows, and you've got to think about this before you start just getting rid of them completely. Randomized sampling is a perfectly good way of selecting your data. Obviously, it has a risk that maybe if the distributions of your genres are a little bit off, and maybe you haven't got very much of a certain genre, you can't guarantee that the distributions are going to be the same on the way out. And if you're trying to predict genre, that's going to be a problem. So perhaps the best approach is stratified sampling. This is where we try and maintain the distribution of our classes. So for example, in this case, genre. So we could say we had 50% rock, 30% pop and 20% spoken, and we want to maintain that kind of distribution on the way out, even if we only sample 50%, right? This is a little bit more complicated than R, but it can be done, right? And this is a good approach if you want to make absolutely sure the distributions of your sample data are the same as the original data. We just looked at some ways we can reduce the size of our data set in terms of the number of instances or the number of rows. Can we make the number of dimensions or the number of attributes smaller, right? Because that's often one of the problems. And the answer is yes, and there's lots of different ways we can do this, some more powerful and useful than others. One of the ways we can do this is something called correlation analysis. So a correlation between two attributes basically tells us that when one of them increases, the other one either increases or decreases in general in relation to it. So you might have some data like this with attribute 1, and we might have attribute 2, and they sort of look like this. These are the data points for all of our different data. Obviously, we've got a lot of data points. And you can see that, roughly speaking, they kind of increase in this sort of direction here, like this. Now, it might be that if this correlation is very, very strong, so basically attribute 2 is a copy of attribute 1, more or less, maybe it doesn't make sense to have attribute 2 in our data set. Maybe we can remove it without too much of a problem. Right? What we can do is something called correlation analysis, where we pitch all of the attributes versus all of the other attributes. We look for high correlations, and we decide ourselves whether to remove them. Right? Now, sometimes it's useful just to keep everything in and try not to remove them too early. But on the other hand, if you've got a huge amount of data and your correlations are very high, this could be one way of doing it. Another option is something called forward or backward attribute selection. Now, this is the idea that maybe we have a machine learning model or a clustering algorithm in mind. We can measure the performance of that, and then we can remove features and see if the performance remains the same. Because if it does, maybe we didn't need those features. So what we could do is we could train our model on, let's say, a 720 dimensional data set, and then we could get a certain level of accuracy and record that. Then we could try it again by removing one of the dimensions and try it on 719, and maybe the accuracy is exactly the same. In which case, we can say, well, we didn't really need that dimension at all, and we can start to whittle down our data set this way. Another option is forwards attribute selection. This is where we literally train our machine learning on just one of the attributes, and then we see what our accuracy is, and we keep adding attributes in and retraining until our performance plateaus, and we can say, you know what, we're not gaining anything now by adding more attributes. Obviously, there's a question of which order do you try this in, usually randomly. So what you would do is you would train on all the data, for example, for backwards attribute selection. You take one out at random. If your performance stays the same, you can leave it out. If your performance gets much worse, you put it back in and you don't try that one again, and you try a different one, right? And you slowly start to take dimensions away and hopefully whittle down your data. Let's have a quick look at correlation analysis on this data set. You might imagine that if we're calculating features based on the MP3 from Libroza or EchoNest, maybe they're quite similar a lot of the time, and maybe we can remove them. Let's have a quick look. So we're just going to focus on one of a set of Libroza features just for simplicity. So we're going to select only the attributes that contain this chroma kurtosis field, which is one of the attributes that you can calculate using Libroza. So I'm going to run that. We're going to rename them just for our own simplicity to KURT1, KURT2, KURT3. And then we're going to calculate a correlation matrix of each of these different features versus each other, like this. Okay. Finally, we're going to plot this and see what it looks like. Hopefully, we can find some good correlations and we could have candidates for just removing a few of these dimensions if it's redundant. And it's not too bad. So you can see that we've got, for example, KURT7 here. So index 7 is fairly similar to 8. That's a correlation of 0.65. Maybe that means that we could remove one of the two of those. This one here is 0.59. We've got a 0.48 over here. These are fairly high correlations. If you were really stretched for CPU time or you're worried about the size of your data set, this is the kind of thing you could do to remove them. Of course, whether 0.65 is a strong enough correlation that you want to delete and completely remove one of these dimensions, it's really up to you and it's going to depend on your situation. One of the reasons that the correlations aren't quite as high as you might think is that these libraries have been designed with this in mind. If EchoNest just produced 200 features that were all exactly the same, it wouldn't be very useful for picking playlists. So they've produced 200 features that are widely different, so they're not necessarily going to correlate all the time. Right? That's the whole point, and that's a really useful feature of this data. We've looked at some ways we can try and make our data set a little bit smaller. Remember, our ultimate goal is the smallest, most sort of useful data we can get our hands on. Right? Then we can put that into machine learning or clustering and really extract some knowledge. The problem is that what we might do, maybe based on correlation analysis or forward, backward attribute selection, we might just be deleting data. Right? And maybe the correlation wasn't one. It wasn't completely redundant. Do we actually want to completely remove this data? Is there another way we can transform our data to make more informed decisions as to what we remove and more effective ones? That's PCA, or principal component analysis. At the moment, we're just fitting one line through our two-dimensional data. There's going to be more principal components later. Right? But what we want to do is we want to pick the direction through this data, however many attributes it has, that has the most spread. So how do we measure this? Well, quite simply.